In this section of our chapter, we begin discussing the Arrhenius equation. This is an equation that helps us define the mathematical relationships between temperature and rate constant. In previous videos, I've mentioned the fact that our rate constant is temperature dependent. So remember, rate constant, we're using our little k, the lowercase k. And the reason that this is temperature dependent is because of a few relationships. So think about a first order rate law, where we can calculate the rate of reaction set equal to the rate constant and the concentration of a reactant, and we're assuming that this is first order. We've already discussed the fact that as temperature increases, we predict and expect the rate of a reaction to increase. And according to our rate law equation here, if the concentration of A is held constant, then the only other factor that it can change in here is our rate constant. So again, as temperature increases, we expect the rate to increase, and to keep our rate law equation true, the rate constant also increases. The original form of the Arrhenius equation is listed here. We do not use this form, we'll use modified versions of it, but just to describe the variables we have in here, the k that we're solving for is our rate constant that has units. A is a quantity called a frequency factor. We will not use that quantity this semester. You'll see it in other equations, but it's never something that we are going to calculate. The activation energy is what we discussed in our previous video, that additional energy that is required for reactant molecules to get over the transition state. And the R value that we're using is our gas constant. If you remember from your first semester chemistry class, you used the gas constant with a value of 0.08206, but that was in liters or units of liters atmosphere per mole Kelvin. This semester, we're still using the gas constant, but we've converted our liters atmospheres into joules, and so that changes the value of it. You'll notice that both of these values of R are on your equation sheet. And then our temperature here will have to be in Kelvin in order to cancel the Kelvins in the R constant. So again, down here at the bottom of the slide, a note about how the value of our rate constant will change with temperature. The first variation of the Arrhenius equation that we use is a variation that works for a data set of four or more points. And this is because we are going to use a graph of data in order to generate a linear plot. So again, notice we have our relationship. Y is our natural log of K. Our slope is our activation energy divided by R with that negative sign in front of the activation energy. X is the inverse of temperature, and B is the natural log of A. Again, A is that frequency factor that we're not going to calculate. So we can get this value from a graph, but we'll never use it. So the key thing to recognize if we want to graph this, recognize that our x-axis would have to be the inverse of temperature values. And so that would have the inverse of Kelvin. Our y-axis would have to be the natural log of our rate constant. So not just the k value, but take the natural log of each k value. And then what this slope is telling us is that we would expect to see a downward sloping trend line. So if we were to go into lab, for example, we can measure the rate constant of different reactions at different temperatures. Take the inverse of temperature for X, the ln of K for Y, plot these data points, and then generate a best fit line. Pretend that's linear. And then the key here, of course, is recognizing that the slope of this line would be equal to the negative activation energy over R. So once we get a value of slope, it allows us to calculate our activation energy. Let's try a quick example here. So taken from the textbook, worked example 1211, we have this equation, decomposition of hydrogen iodide. The temperature show, or the data shown on the left half of this table, the first two columns, show our temperatures converted into Kelvin for five different trials. From those temperature values, we calculate the rate constant associated with it. Based on the units, we can tell that this is overall second order. The order does not matter for this equation, by the way, but we can tell from the units. And so these are our given K values. And notice the trend here. Again, as temperature increases, going down this column, our K values also increase. But in order to generate our linear plot, we have to take the inverse of every temperature. So this 555, 1 divided by that value is how we get this temperature. For our ln of K column, we take each K value, each rate constant, take the natural log of that, and that's how we get each of these values. And so it's these two columns that we are going to generate a plot for. When we do that, notice we get this linear equation for our best fit line. Now again, the key in this equation is recognizing that our slope is equivalent to the negative activation energy over R. And I forgot to specifically mention that this linear form of the Arrhenius equation is on your equation sheet. And so this is the key part that you need to recognize and remember from this version. Now our goal in this equation is to be able to calculate activation energy. So to isolate this and get it by itself, I'm going to move my negative sign over first, and then I have my slope times my R value. And so to solve this, we take our slope value. Notice here that is the negative. Notice our slope itself has a negative sign in here. So the negative 22287. I'm going to leave a space here. We're going to come back and talk about units. And then multiply my R constant, joules per mole per Kelvin. So two things to note. One, we're going to come back and talk about units, but notice also the signs in here. So our equation has the negative in it, and our slope also has the negative in it. Remember when we introduced the idea of activation energy, we mentioned that this is always going to be a positive value, always, no exceptions. And so if you forget to track one of your negative signs through, remember to make your activation value positive. All right, so now let's talk about the units of slope. Remember, in general, when we're calculating slope, if you remember back to your algebra days, our slope is calculated as rise over run. Well, the rise is our y-axis. And the ln of k is a unitless quantity. Once we take the natural log of something, we can't have any units there. So we have no units for our y-axis. For our run, the x-axis, our units are 1 over Kelvin. With all of this, the units of our slope turn out to be just Kelvin. I don't expect you to remember that or memorize it, but realize that for purposes of units, it means our Kelvins will cancel. When we plug all of these quantities in, we get an unrounded value of 185,294. And now we need to discuss sig figs. To determine how many sig figs to report in here, we go back to our original table. And so notice that our original measured data, our temperature and K values, all these values go to 3 sig figs. And so for this answer, we're going to be limited to 3 sig figs as well. Notice right now the units that we're left with are joules per mole. However, activation energy is usually such a large value of energy that we write it in kilojoules per mole. And so it is common to convert this into kilojoules, which also makes our sig figs reporting easier. So to report for 3 sig figs, I have 185 kilojoules per mole as the value for our activation energy. I'm going to pause here or stop the video here. Our next video will be a second variation of the Arrhenius equation.